Hi there and welcome back. Let's now have a look at producing structured output from the Responses API. A very common use of large language models is to send it some unstructured data. So this could be something like an image or a piece of text. And we can then ask the model to extract information from that content and return it in a structured way, like a JSON structure. OpenAI realized that this is a very common scenario, and therefore they've greatly improved the way in which the API can produce structured output. If you use the completions SDK or API, you might say that you can also produce structured output using those features, but with the responses API, there's even a better way of getting the data, which also ensures type adherence. If we have a look at the documentation, we can see that structured output is a feature that ensures that the model will always generate responses that adhere to your supplied JSON schema. So if you ever use JSON mode, you might run into issues where the model would hallucinate a value in one of the fields, or perhaps it gets the type wrong completely. With this new structured output feature, you get reliable type safety, and you also get simpler prompting. You also get explicit refusals, and this is just a built-in safety feature within this program that will tell you if the model refused to extract certain information. They still kept the section for the JSON mode here, but you will notice this warning saying that JSON mode is a more basic version of structured output, and while JSON mode ensures that the model output is valid JSON, structured output reliably matches the model's output to the schema you specified. So OpenAI themselves recommend that you use structured output instead of JSON mode. In this video, I will show you both approaches because you might have some edge cases where you have no choice, but I would recommend using the structured output feature instead. Let's start by looking at JSON mode and then we'll move on to the newer structured output feature. Here we've got some boilerplate code, and if you followed along with the series, this should all look familiar to you. We've simply set up an initial message, and we're then passing that message to the responses API and printing out our response. So if we had to run this file in the terminal, our model will say, "Hello, how can I assist you?" Cool, so now that we know everything is set up correctly, let's write some code. First, let's have a look at JSON mode. If you're interested in learning how to use structured output, which is the recommended way, then simply jump forward to that section in the video. Let's say we have this sentence. Alice and Bob are going to a science fair on Friday. Now, we want our model to extract certain information from the sentence and return a JSON structure. In fact, we're expecting a JSON structure in the following format. We want the name of the event, we want the date, the location, as well as a list of attendees. And of course, this needs to be returned as a JSON structure. Now, with JSON mode, we have to do the following. We have to prompt the model to return the data in this specific format. So what we could do is, let's just expand this a bit so we can use a new line, like so. And now we also have to add respond with a JSON object with the following keys. And then we can add the structure that we want. And then when we create the response, we have to add a key called text, which is equal to a dictionary. And then we have to specify a new key called format colon, and this takes in a dictionary as well with a key called type. And for the value, we can enter JSON object, like so. This will now enable JSON mode. So if we run this code again, and we can see the model is now returning only the JSON object with the exact properties that we asked for. Now we might still have to go and parse this into a JSON structure that we can use, but for the most part, this seems okay. However, if you've ever tried to actually use JSON mode, you might run into issues where the model actually hallucinates some of these fields, or it provides a completely wrong answer. For example, it might return the date as some numeric value or in a format that you didn't expect. And then what you'd have to do to try and improve the results is to add additional content to your prompt. Like you might have to add specific rules like the date should be in the following format, and still this might not be reliable enough. Now with the new structured output feature, the API will look at the JSON schema and ensure that the data being returned is in the exact format that we're expecting. So let's have a look at converting this code from JSON mode using the new structured output feature offered by the Responses API. So let's change this to structured output mode. And now for the content, we don't have to specify the JSON structure in the prompt itself. All we have to do is pass in the text or image, by the way, that we want to extract the information from. In fact, after running the text, I will actually show you how to extract information from an image as well. So let's do the same thing. We've got our piece of text, and then let's make a change to this text property, and we'll change the format from JSON object to JSON schema instead. Next, we need to provide a name property, and this value is anything we want, like calendar event. We need to provide a property called schema, and this is where we can define the schema of this JSON structure. So in this dictionary, we'll define this type as object. And by the way, this is simply a normal JSON schema. And if you don't know how to build this up yourself, you could just ask something like ChatGPT to do it for you. But let's continue typing this out. Then let's define the properties of this object. And the first one we want to extract is the name of the event. And each of these properties take in a dictionary as well. And here we can provide the type as type string. Let's add another property below the name and let's call this one date. And again, we'll pass in a dictionary. Let's also enter the type as string. At this point, you can actually change the type to anything you want, like number or Boolean, etc. All we want is string. Let's add another property called location, and this again takes in a dictionary as input with a type of string as well. Now for the last value, we want to return a list of values. Like for the attendees, we want to return a list of string values. So to do that, let's call this property attendees. This takes in a dictionary, and for the type, we'll set this equal to an array. And now we also have to specify the type for each of the items in the array. So let's pass in a key called items, and then items, we also have to specify the type, and this will just be the type that each of the items should be, which is of type string. Cool, so far we've defined the type as a JSON schema, we've given it some name, and we've now defined the schema as containing all of these properties. We can also tell the model which of these properties are mandatory or optional. We can do that by adding another key below the properties key, and this key we'll call required. And this takes in a list of values, and here we can specify which properties we need to get back, at the very least. So I want everything, the name, the date, the location, and the attendees. And finally, let's add another property called additional properties, and this is of value false. And finally, below the schema key, so it's just below this yellow bracket down here, we can add our final property called strict, and this will set to true because we want the model to strictly conform to everything we set out in the schema. So yes, this might seem like more work compared to just injecting all of this into the prompt, but if you're building production-grade applications, it's critical that the API gets all of these types correct. And now all we have to do to tie all of this together, the schema and this prompt, is to improve our system instruction slightly. So let's tell this agent what its function is. And we're not going to specify the schema in the system prompt. We're only going to tell this agent what its role is. So let's say, extract the event information, and then let's run this again in the terminal. And we get the response containing the name, the date, the location is blank, and we've got the attendees. So we don't have a location because we didn't specify it in the string. So let's add Alice and Bob are going to a science fair in New York on Friday. Right, now let's run this again in the terminal. And look at that. This time we do get the location back as well. Cool. Now we're able to extract structured output from any text. What about images? So let's say we have a food menu like this. This is a simple PNG image. And let's say we actually want to extract all the menu items from this image and return the items along with their prices in a JSON structure. So what we can do is add this image to our project folder, and then I'm simply going to copy some code across from lesson 2 where we learned how to work with images and the responses API. So if you're unsure of what I'm doing here and why I'm doing it, definitely check out that video as well. So first, let's copy over our function to encode the image. I'm also going to copy over base64, like so. Then let's base64 encode our image, like so. And what we want is not image, but menu.png. Then for the input messages, we'll actually copy the content list from this example and add it into this code. So what we'll do is we'll only send one image, which is this base64 version of the image. And let's make sure we only have one content property. Cool. So we are passing in the image. Let's also ask it to please extract all menu items. Cool. So then in the responses create, we can actually omit the system instructions since we are prompting it in our input message. And then for the JSON schema, let's make a few changes. So I'm going to rename this to menu items. Then for the properties, I'm actually going to remove name, location, and date. So we're only left with this array. Let's rename this from attendees to menu items, which is of type array. And now each of these items in the list will be an object by itself, containing the item's name and price. So let's change this type from string to object. And because this is now an object, we have to specify its properties. So let's do properties. This takes in a dictionary. And let's call this one item name. And this has a type of string. And let's also add another property called item price, like so. And for the type, we'll make this a number. Cool. So we've renamed this to menu items. And in the schema, we have a high level list or an array. And for each of the items, we're expecting an object with two properties, item name and item price. Then under the required fields, let's delete all of this and let's only pass back menu items. And before I forget, whenever you define an object, you need to specify these two properties. So obviously we've done this for this root object called menu items, but we have to do the same for this object as well. So at the same level of properties, let's simply paste in that array. And I'm just going to fix my indentation. And then the required properties is item name and item price. These two properties over here. So if you do run into any issues, just keep in mind you have to do this every time you declare an object. So over here and over here. Cool. Let's finally run this. And this time we are passing in an image and not text. And hopefully we'll get an array back with all the menu items with their names and prices. Which it seems we do. We receive this JSON structure with a root property called menu items. This property is an array. And for these items, we have a cheeseburger along with the price, and the price is also a numeric value. How cool is that? Are you enjoying this series? If you are, let me know down in the comments. Hit the like button and subscribe. In the next video, we will be looking at the built-in tools offered by the Responses API. And we will also have a look at creating custom functions. And finally, we'll learn how to use computer use to give our AI assistant control over our machine. I'll see you in the next one.